On today's episode of the Box2Box podcast, the guys go for a pre-season review, looking forward to who they think is going to be the champion of the Premier League, also through to relegation, the top four, and a few other things that they think is going to happen this year. On to the podcast we go. Hello, 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 and welcome to the first episode of the Box2Box podcast for the 2022-2023 Premier League season. This podcast will be a weekly podcast discussing everything that's happened in the Premier League from the week before, and also discussing the week commencing, or weekend commencing, depending on what day the pod will come out. On today's episode, I'm joined by Reza. How's it going, mate? You alright?
Yeah, I'm alright.
Feeling a heavy weekend.
There's more than a it was just intense, man. Just intense.
Nice.
This was, it was good. It was good, don't get me wrong.
Good.
It's a bloody expensive place to go, though. Really, expensive place. And it was just relentless. It was just non-stop. And like I say, when we left, we flew back home, our flight left Sunday night, and I was just so ready to go home at that point. It was like Sunday morning, woke up in Vegas, watched the Women's European Championships final.
Yeah.
And at that point, throughout the whole game, I was just sat there like, I just want to go home now. but we had a late night flight.
Yeah.
And then, obviously, it's 8 hours behind with a 10-hour flight. So it's like an 18-hour time difference in terms of flight.
Oh, God.
Back to Brighton.
Yeah.
And it was just, Monday night. And to what I say, I haven't fully recovered yet. and I certainly won't be going back in a hole. Don't get me wrong. It's not because it wasn't good. It was good. It was just, I'm feeling it. I am feeling it.
Nice. Sounds like you got a good weekend. That's the main thing.
Yeah.
So on today's podcast, we're just going to do a little season preview, just to get the feels of how we feel the season is going to go. There's a number of different topics. We'll both give our opinions on both on everything. We've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 topics that myself and Reza have picked out that we think will be the main things going forward into this season. So we'll start off winner. Of the Premier League, this year's Premier League, who do you think the winner is going to be, Rez?
I can't see past Man City. They've signed well. They've sold well. I just can't see past them. To be honest, I think adding Haaland to the ranks is massive. They lacked a goal scorer last year, right? And you look at how well they did. I just think they'll win it with, it won't be as close. I don't think it'll be anywhere near as tight this season as it was last season. I just can't see beyond them, unfortunately.
I can see what you're saying. When we were discussing this about the winner for next year, we won't get into what I said last year. I can't see past City. I think they've done good getting rid of some of the players they've got rid of. And then signing Haaland for me is just, you think, I was having a discussion with someone at work today about it. I genuinely think teams like Fulham he's just going to truck through. It's just going to be how Suarez loves scoring against Norwich.
Yeah.
It's going to be similar situation to that. To Haaland, to some of the little boys in the Premier League, they're not just going to be able to deal with him. He's too quick for you. He's too strong for you. They're not going to have dealt with that before. So I think he's going to be an absolute beast. Beast this year, and I can't see past City winning the Premier League. When you say that I think they'll win it by a lot, I don't actually think they're going to win it by a lot, and I think the gap has closed a little bit. In terms of, I think Liverpool will still be there. Even though they got rid of Mane, I still think that Nunes will be a brilliant signing. I don't think he's £100 million worth of player, but he's still a good signing. And you've got to think Luis Diaz, Salah, Jota has still they've still got a good, very good front three, and they're still going strong. So I think Liverpool will push them, but City will edge it for me.
Yeah. Oh yeah, mate. Like we'll get into the rest of the top four, but Liverpool will be the only team that will be able to lay a glove on them.
Yeah.
But I just can't. Realistically, I just cannot see it being that close.
As I close understand what you're saying.
But who knows, right? I mean, I didn't think it'd be as close as it was last year either.
Yeah, no, but of course. So you never know what's going to happen.
But I think top four is going to be interesting.
Yeah, top I think it will be as well. Yeah, I do as well. So leads us nicely onto the next topic we've got here. So to round off the top four, obviously take City out of it. And I think we could probably take Liverpool out of it because I think both of us are going to say Liverpool no matter what.
Yeah.
That's definitely nailed on top four. So who are you seeing taking the other two top four places?
I think it's going to be Arsenal and Chelsea.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I've been really impressed with Arsenal pre-season. I think Gabby Jesus is a really good signing for them. I think Zinchenko's a good signing for them. I think that you're starting to see the fruits of the labour, so to speak. Arteta ball. You've got. I think Odegaard was superb last year, and I think he'll only kick on and get even better. I think they've got a solid team there, and they're building towards something. I think that, for me, it's Arsenal, and I'd actually put Arsenal in third, and then Chelsea fourth.
Fair enough. I've gone a little bit different than yourself. I've actually gone Spurs and Chelsea.
Okay.
Just Spurs signing Bissouma and their midfield, strengthening their midfield. I think that was a great signing. Keeping Harry Kane will be a massive... If they can keep Harry Kane and keep Bayern Munich away from him. And I think their front three of Harry Kane, Son and Kulusevski. They've strengthened their defence. I think they'll be... I actually thought they would be third, possibly pushing on to maybe on the heels of Liverpool. And then the last spot between Chelsea, Arsenal and United, I don't think United would get there unless somehow we can miraculously unless Frankie De Jong comes with Celso and maybe one other as well, possibly we might be able to push for that fourth spot, but Chelsea,
yeah, I mean,
it depends on signings.
Yeah, United does massively, so I think that the Ronaldo saga needs to be dealt with.
Yeah.
To be honest, I think he needs to go. My opinion, I know that Army will completely disagree with everything that we say here, but he's been a right bell end.
The problem is no one wants him. That's the problem. And I think he thought that a lot of people would want him, but no one wants him.
Yeah, and now he's kind of realised that his stock's not as high as he thought it was.
Yeah.
Now he's throwing massive hissy fits and just being a joke, basically. And it's really destabilising. It's really not what we wanted. We got rid of the likes of Pogba and Lingard and those types of players. We didn't need this from someone like him, who just a few weeks ago was saying that he was going to stay.
Yeah, I know.
So something changed. What changed? Like what happened? What triggered in his mind? And it's all a very... Basically, there was a reason that Juve were quite happy to see the back of him. There's a reason that Real and Bayern and all of those teams have distanced themselves from him.
Yeah.
No one wants him.
No one does.
Because he doesn't contribute.
No, that's the problem.
He contributes with goals. He scores goals. But the game's changed. It's evolved. You need more than that. But United are way short. The De Jong saga's been an embarrassment again. It's just typical United, really.
Yeah, it has been the whole summer.
It's just been an absolute embarrassment. It sounds like they're pushing for it to be done this week. Romano tweeted.
Yeah, I saw the 13th. Basically, the Liga have said to Barcelona, you have until the 13th of August to register your players. From what I was seeing, that... if they want to register Lewandowski, Rafinha, Koundé, Kessié and Christensen, from Chelsea, then De Jong has to go.
Right.
If he doesn't go or doesn't take a wage cut, a massive wage cut that is, then they cannot register all those players.
Right. Yeah,
So,
so I mean, it should hopefully have it, but Chelsea apparently are sniffing hard now as
they
well.
seem to be sniffing on a lot of our top. They're off that sales guy as well, that kid from RB Salzburg, is it? I think Salzburg. We're trying to sign a youngster, and they're
Yeah.
sniffing around him as well. They're the other club that was apparently in for him or wanting him. So they're sniff. I think they're just doing what Chelsea, what Barca were doing to them, really. They're trying to sniff around
Yeah.
and to try and get some because they got Champions League. They're trying to get nick a few of the players off some of the teams that haven't.
Yeah.
But yeah, United's obviously, like I say, that United's top four chances are determined by who they get in this window and January as well.
Yeah.
So that I can't really say much about them at the moment. And then I just for some reason I feel like Arsenal aren't going to have a good year this year. I think like the pre-season is like tainted their eyes a little bit, and I think,
You reckon?
yeah, I
Yeah,
don't
I
know
mean,
what it
it
is. I've
could
just got
be.
a
They could be
feeling about
flattering to
it.
deceive.
Like pre-season to me, I don't really give a fuck about. I just want my players to be super fit. That's what I really care about pre-season. Obviously, winning
Yeah.
is nice. Winning is brilliant, but it's all about just blowing the cobwebs away and of the summer and getting them fit and ready for the new season. So I don't really
Yeah.
take like we beat Liverpool 4-0. Like you don't really take that as a 4-0 win against Liverpool. Like I take that as a it should have they should have scored a couple of goals themselves, and I don't really take it as like a win. I'm not sitting there going, fuck hell, yes, we beat Liverpool 4-0. Fucking what a result. I'm not sitting there doing that. It's pre-season. I don't care.
Yeah.
It's fitness for me. So I just feel like Arsenal, I could be completely wrong and I could be wrong, but I said Saka wasn't going to have the best of years last year, and he didn't really have that good of a year. After the Euros, everyone was, I said he's not that good. He shouldn't really be in the England team, and everyone I know was saying to me, how could you say that? He's unbelievable. And I was like, he's not as good as what you lot are saying he is. And towards the back end of last season sort of proved me right. So I just don't feel like they're going to have that good of a year this year. I think they're relying on quite a lot on some of their overseas signings to hit the ground running. In my eyes, Gabriel Jesus really is just a Brazilian Lacazette. And Lacazette doesn't score that many goals.
Yeah, no, I mean, I completely understand why you'd say that, and like it's I had a tendency to feel the same initially, but having seen the way he's applying himself in pre-season, I've been really impressed. And again, like you say, it is only pre-season, right? So it's hard, you can't draw any conclusions from it, but it looks like he's ready to hit the ground running, and he looks like he's got a point to prove. I mean, he never really got a proper shot at City, I think. So he's obviously a very, very talented player. And actually, Lacazette had a massive drop off. So Lacazette's first couple of seasons at Arsenal were actually really impressive.
Yeah.
Then he tailed off dramatically. So if Jesus can replicate early Arsenal form for Lacazette,
Yeah.
rather than late, then actually they've got a decent signing on their hands there still. So yeah, like I say, it'd be interesting, but I just think we're starting to see things move, and I think I know what you're saying about Spurs, and Spurs have done well. They've strengthened their squad more than their first team.
Yeah.
I don't think necessarily their first team. Bissouma, yeah, okay, probably, but otherwise, I don't see their first 11 having been strengthened. It's just the squad's better now, which is why I don't think they'll be quite as good as like obviously like you're saying. But it'll be interesting. It'd be like it's going to be tight. I think it's going to be much more tight than it was last season for sure.
Yeah, I think Chelsea for me. I just think the reason why I've put them fourth, I just think they will sign more players than they sign. I think Koulibaly is an unbelievable signing for them, and they're also talking about that young centre back from RB Leipzig with a swap deal. If they get him, and with Sterling, and I don't rate Sterling that highly as much as what other people seem to rate him, but he's still an unbelievable, well, I say unbelievable, a very good winger.
Yeah, he'll get them goals.
He'll get them
he'll
goals.
Get them
of course,
of
he'll
goals.
get them goals. And it's just whether they can sign maybe a striker to go with it or another winger. Obviously, Havertz could probably still play in that false nine that he's been playing in so well.
Yeah,
and
I
just
think
they'll
that'll
be very
be the
hard.
Plan for them.
I think they'll be very hard to beat this year, Chelsea, more than they'll be blowing teams out of the water. I think they'll just be very difficult to beat. With Thiago Silva, Koulibaly at the back, I think it'll be very difficult to break that down.
It's slow, though.
Well, they're probably they only play three at the back, didn't they, with Reece James and Cucurella, to be fair, on the wings, wing backs. So I think they'll be very, very hard to beat. And yeah, I think they'll be very good this year. So yeah, that's why I for top four, I just put Chelsea / United, just depending on who we sign. If we don't sign anyone, if we don't sign De Jong, then there's no chance we're getting top four. If we sign De Jong, maybe Anthony and that young kiddie, that Selko, then possibility. But I'd still probably edge more towards Chelsea.
Yeah, fair.
Right, so that does top four. Relegation. Who's the three teams you think are going to get relegated?
I think it's going to be two of the teams that have come up. So I think Bournemouth and Forest.
Okay.
And then I think Southampton.
Okay.
As well, I was tempted to go Everton, just because it'd still be funny, but I can't see it. I can't see them being as bad as they were last year. So yeah, I think it's those three for me. In what order, I don't know. But yeah, those three.
I've gone similar route, but one's going to shock you really badly. So I've gone Fulham and Bournemouth. I think Forest will stay up. They've signed a couple of players that have gone under the radar, and they've made a couple of signings that I think are going to be very good for them. Not Lingard, but other signings. And then my third team, I think, are going to go Wolves.
Oh, really?
I think Wolves are going to go down this year.
That's big.
It's a big, big statement that I'm making with this prediction. But I genuinely think. I think Wolves are going to go down. I think the form they started to show towards the end of last season, it depends on what Wolves turns up. I think those days are going to be over. I don't think they're going to be as good as what they've been in previous years. And there's a few players that that I've seen that are going to be linked, being linked away. And I don't think they're going to be able to replace him if they do end up going.
Neves is being linked, isn't he, to us again?
Yeah, there's Neto who's been linked, who's a very key player for them. Jimenez has been linked to somebody as well. I can't remember who linked someone to Jimenez. And I think one of their defenders, I can't remember what defender it was linked somewhere else as well. I think if they lose those three to four players, I think they could be in very big trouble. That's why I've put them in my bottom three. And,
I wonder what the odds are.
God knows, I haven't even looked, to be fair. I haven't even looked. Right, I think that covers off relegation. I think there's not much else you can really say. You don't really like talking about relegation side of things. It's never nice to speak to the people you think are going to go down. So we'll move on to one to watch. So a player you think this year is going to be one to watch that you think is going to be very, very, very good. I've tried to avoid the obvious in Haaland in my choice. I'll let you go first. Who's a player that you think is one to watch?
Oh, it's a tough one. There's a few that I think... I mean, I'm interested to see Conor Gallagher this year. Going back to Chelsea, whether we can actually make the jump, because he was superb for Palace last year, absolutely superb.
Yeah.
But I'm gonna go for Gabby Jesus.
Okay.
I think like you say, like you, what would you say? Oh, right, he's like Brazilian Lacazette. I think a lot of people think that.
Yeah.
And I think he's better than that. And I personally, like I said, I think it's going to be an interesting season to see what and how he does.
Okay.
So I'm going to go with, Gabby Jesus.
Fair enough. I went for someone that's actually already a player for a club. So he didn't sign this year, he signed in January. Bruno from Newcastle.
Okay.
I think he's gonna. I for some reason, I don't know what it is, I feel like Newcastle can have an absolute brilliant year. Just the way they finished last year, I still think they're gonna strengthen in some areas. They've strengthened their defence massively. And I think Eddie Howe has actually gotten playing some nice football towards the end of last year.
Yeah.
So I think they're going to do quite well, and I think a lot does rest on his shoulders because he does, when he's playing well, the team tends to play even better. With Saint Max on the wing, anything's possible, and I think Bruno's going to have a great year. If I had to pick signings, brand new signings, I think Nunes for Liverpool is going to have an unbelievable season. I wish we would have got him, but I understand why the club didn't want to spend 100 million on him, but I wish we would have got him.
But also, I think he didn't want to come either. Like, he
Yeah, no,
wanted Champions
I
League.
understand that.
Again, it's in terms of position, you can understand. I mean, geographically, it's similar. Obviously, it's northwest of England.
Yeah,
It's
well, every footballer
hate
lives in Cheshire,
everything.
don't
So,
they, really? In
yeah. So,
Manchester.
at this moment in time, taking the fact that we support Man United aside, if you're offered an opportunity to sign for Liverpool United and
At
you
this
know they've
moment,
just sold Mane, so
yeah.
you're basically, you're not going there to sit on the bench, or you're not going there for next season or the season after that, you're going there for the here and now,
Yeah.
then I can't see any reason, unfortunately, and it pains me to say it, but why would you pick United? The
No,
club's a
I understand what
shambles
you're
at the
saying.
moment.
No, I get what you're saying.
We've chased De Jong. It's like we're doing the same thing we did every single. We've done it all the time. It's the same thing as, do you remember Fabregas, the whole Fabregas saga? It
Yeah.
was a joke. It's an embarrassment. It's the same thing again. And it's, yeah, why would you go to a club? But I think he looks like an exciting player. It's going to be very, very interesting because obviously people are trying to draw comparisons between him and Haaland. They're very different players. They're very different footballers.
Yeah.
I think Haaland will outscore him. But I've got a feeling that Nunes will prove to be a better foot. But we'll see. We'll
Yeah.
see.
By the way, yeah, that's my two one to watches. That's who I believe. I've Bruno from Newcastle, and then obviously Nunes. If I
Yeah.
had to pick a new signing this year, I'd say Nunes.
Fair.
Right. So move on next to signing of the summer.
Yeah.
I know exactly. Before I didn't even have to write this down. I knew it before I even asked the question. But who's your signing of the summer?
Oh, you know my one, do you?
No, mine. I know. I before I even sent the message to you to say the sign of the summer, that's the first one on my list.
I'm going Calvin Phillips.
Okay.
I think he's a fantastic footballer, and I'm really excited and interested to see how he does it. I think that he improves what is already a really impressive midfield.
Yeah.
And I think he's got all the right attributes to be a real success at that club.
Yeah, no,
So
he's.
yeah, the price they paid for him, when you look at the market and the prices players go for, what was it, 45?
Yeah, it was 45.
I think it's gonna be, I think that's an absolute bargain, to be
Yeah,
honest.
no, I know what you mean.
So yeah, Calvin Phillips for me.
Yeah, no, I get what you mean. Mine was Haaland. Oh, I just signed in the summer.
Fair enough.
Just for the money they
Yeah,
paid for
get
him as
the
well.
money. Yeah, I think the thing is with that though, everyone knew how much it was. Do you know what I mean? It wasn't. There was a clause in his contract to say that's how much he was going to cost, and it all came down to who was willing to pay the vulture. Obviously, I say that. I mean, it's bad because obviously the guy's dead now, but who was willing to pay the fees to him to
Yeah.
get Haaland. And it wasn't that much of a surprise of a transfer.
Yeah.
And I know that doesn't mean that it's not the signing of the summer, but I just don't know about him either. Like, I don't know. He'll score goals. He will score goals. You can see that he's just a talented boy, and he will definitely score goals for City. I mean, if you could put almost any striker in the Premier League up top for City, they will score goals.
Yeah.
How good a footballer is he? really. We're about to find out, I think, because the German league is very difficult as well. Look at the players coming from the Bundesliga to the Premier League, and it can be quite hit and miss.
Yeah.
So
I know what you mean.
I mean, I'm intrigued. Players. I am massively intrigued by the Haaland situation. So, but I think that, from, like, yeah, like I say, it's.
I would have if it had been more like smaller. Well, I say more smaller. If it had been smaller, maybe not as fast. And not got for me, he's got every key instinct, every key feature you'd need for a Premier League player. He's big. He's quick.
Yeah.
He's strong.
And he's got the right attitude as well.
He's got the right attitude. He's confident. A miss like he had the other day against Liverpool, that's not going to bother him. He'll just bang the next one in. Like that's the right attitude to have. And I don't want to say he's like a Drogba in a way. Like, remember when Drogba first came to the Premier League, how quick, powerful, and how he's sort of similar to that.
But I'm worried that he becomes another Lukaku. That's basically what I'm thinking, is that Lukaku's big. He's like powerful, he's quick, and he can finish.
I think he's got better attitude than Lukaku, and I think he's got a better touch than Lukaku.
Mate, my mum's got a better fucking touch than Lukaku.
My nephew's got one. anyway, cool. I can't wait to see him. I can't wait to see him in the Premier League this year. I wish he was at United. I love having the best players. I love watching the best players in the world. So I wish he was at United, but I think he's going to be unbelievable in the Prem.
Fair.
But yeah, so that's my sign in the summer. We'll move on to the next one. I hate this this next topic, but we always have to ask the question. First manager to be sacked.
Yeah, well, I mean, obviously, I was mega wrong last season.
We both were, mate, to be fair.
With Pat Vieira. I mean, just couldn't have got it more wrong. I'm going to go Frank Lampard.
Frank Lampard. That's a good shout, to be fair. I've gone for the Wolves manager, Bruno Lage. I think if they lose the players that is being mentioned that they're going to lose, I don't think he keeps his job past September. I don't think he'll be there.
Yeah.
But yeah, I always hate the topic because I hate seeing someone sacked. But we have to ask the difficult questions here. So we move on to the last topic, the last one for the pre-season. Top goal scorer.
Yeah, I think this is fairly easy. It's going to be Haaland.
Yeah, I see. I still thought though Salah is in for a shout. And also, I don't know, with a Son or Harry Kane, I don't know who's going to have the better year. If it's the same as last year, then Son could go run riot again this year. If Harry Kane's going to drop as deep as he has been. But yeah, I still think Haaland as well, the same as yourself. But I do think that Salah and what's his name? Son would have a good year as well.
Interestingly enough, so I'm just going to describe it. Let's see. So, Haaland is favourite, followed by Salah. Then it's Kane, Nunes and Gabi Jesus level, 11-1. And then it's Son, 14-1. Mate, I'll tell you what, 14-1 for Son, you stick a 5-10er on that. I'm surprised he's as far out as that, to be honest.
I am a little bit as well, to be fair.
And I'm surprised Nunes and Jesus are higher than he is.
Looking at the odds to be relegated as well. Wolves are 4-1 to be relegated.
Yeah, it might be worth a tenner, mate.
They're the eighth favourite team to go down. Bournemouth, Forest, Fulham, Leeds, Brentford, Southampton, Everton, then Wolves. Is the order that they've put it in to go down.
Yes, he's Bournemouth odds on, which I'm not surprised by. I think Bournemouth and Forest, I can definitely see. Fulham have signed a few, so. But then, like you say, Sarah Forest. But yeah, I've got a feeling Southampton will go, but we'll see. We will see.
We'll see.
Brighton now to 9-1.
Yeah, Bet365 are giving 8-1 on them.
So, I mean, yeah. That's the we can dream, right?
Well, no, I'm joking. Apparently, Graham Potter said this is the best squad he's ever had. So, I'm predicting Europe, mate. Must be minimum.
What, with Kukurea gone, Bissouma gone.
Apparently so.
They're in Cloud Cuckoo Land, that lot. But, anyways.
Jesus, I was just going through a couple of things. Golden Glove, yeah. Mendy for Chelsea is 8-1 to win the Golden Glove for the Premier League. That's most amount of clean sheets.
It could be that's not a bad shout.
That's not a bad shout at all. 8-1 for him, because I think they're going to keep. I think it's going to be very hard to score against Chelsea this year.
How is Hugo Lloris better odds? Well, worse. Yeah, well, better. I mean, worse odds technically than Mendy. As in, how is Lloris a bigger favourite to keep more clean sheets than Mendy? That's nuts, mate.
Lloris is 10-1 on Bet365.
Oh, is he 7-1 on Sky now? That's mad. 8-1 for Mendy.
PFA Player of the Year. Haaland is favourite, then Salah, then De Bruyne.
I think De Bruyne is going to have a season where he's good. But I think we're going to start to see the tail off of De Bruyne. I think there were just moments last season where you could see he was very up and down. I know he had obviously injury problems and everything. So it's probably the reason for it. But I do think that we're going to start to see.
He is 31, to be fair. So
he is, yeah.
He's getting to that point where he is.
Top four. So. Fucking hell. So City, Liverpool. Oh, interestingly enough, City, Liverpool, Spurs, Chelsea, they're all odds on. And then you've got Arsenal at 6-4.
Yeah, United at 7-4.
They seem pretty set on the top four. I can understand why, but like I said, I think Arsenal have the I might have to put a couple of little bets on. Yeah. I can't do it. Actually, because I can't have that on my
bank slide. Laura go mental.
Yeah, it's more obviously the banks are going, well, hang on a second. Because I don't gamble. So, I've got 0% outgoings to gambling.
Goes to Vegas, comes all of a sudden back.
That's it. Just as I'm just about to buy a house, start betting on Premier League football again. So I'll have to leave it.
Right, I think that does it for this week's episode. Preview, should I say. Thank you very much for listening, guys. Me and myself and Reza will be back every single week to give you a post-match or post-weekend review, and then to look forward to and a pre-match, to be fair, for the week coming up. Every single week. We'll probably still keep it as a Wednesday. We might change it depending on conversation with me and Rez. If we feel like we want to put it on a different night, or it'd be better on a different night. Thank you very much for listening. If you want to appear in the podcast, let us know. Reach out to us on any of our socials and we'll get some people on. We'll hope to have a few more guests this year just so that we can get a bit more diversity in terms of fans, that is, rather than just two Man United fan opinions. But thank you very much for listening, and we'll see you in the next one.
Awesome.